My name is Milind Patel. I'm a research assistant. So today I am going to talk about and also give some insight on the safety perspective for autonomous cars. So I'll introduce you to the main concepts and layout of the safety aspects that is made in the relevant field, and also we'll be highlighting some analysis techniques that are currently deployed by the industry. I wish you good luck as you get started and really hope you enjoy this module. Like I have also prepared the seminar in such a way that for the participants, you don't need any programming or some mathematical skills to accomplish. So yeah, let's first have a look on the learning objective of today. First is safety requirements. So on what basis of factors we consider something as really safe and what's its overall contribution to the industry. Also, we will be examining some main grounds or main factors of the autonomous driving failures and some standard frameworks from the industry perspective, and we'll be defining some safety goals, item description, and various approaches for the safety assessment methods and for the validation of the safety of autonomous cars. So I'll dive quickly into the basics of safety. So throughout the webinar, we'll discuss some of the recent vehicle crash report and discuss also the main sources of hazard. As I mentioned, so till the end of seminar, we'll be going through all the safety concepts. What are the main hazard sources, industry perspective, safety methodology, terminology, some frameworks, assessment methods, and we'll summarize by the end of this. Okay, so let's start with a discussion of some of the more prominent autonomous vehicle failures to date. Let's say there are two examples here on the screen. You can see an Uber self-driving vehicle. On the left, you can see that overreacted during a minor collision that was caused by another vehicle and it ended up overturning. You can see. And also on the right, you can see that there is a Volvo car that comes. It's safe to say it comes with a very fairly advanced driver assist system that includes everything. Autonomic emergency braking that are capable enough to detect the vehicle, pedestrians, cyclists. However, still the tech wasn't active when one of the Uber crash happened and results into fatal accident in Temple, Arizona. So this was the crash report of 2018. It involves a car. We'll go deeply into the case study. So we'll come to know what are the main cause behind this failure. So incident happened when car struck a woman she was walking her bicycle across the street. And it was the first fatally known self-driving vehicle hitting a pedestrian. See, we don't want people to be confused or it wasn't the failure of technology. So you might wonder whom to blame and what the things that can go wrong. So I'll show you the bird eye view. So you can see, you cannot see, but I made the marking so you can have an idea. So from the left, the pedestrian was entering and the vehicle was traveling along the way. You can see in the bottom of the image, and there is a red spot where the body was found. So after the investigation, it revealed that there were multiple failures that led to an accident. So let's work with the different contributing factors to that. Firstly, I must say there were no real checks on the safety driver. Also in this case, the safety driver was inattentive and maybe watching some Netflix at that time. Overall conclusion is it was still not safe. So the safety driver could be doing anything. And Uber don't necessarily have to be access the vehicle and driver attentiveness, because it was designed with such a system that it has to be autonomous driving car, right? So watching and or monitoring, you can say the driver, the system operates, it's really a difficult task to stay focused on. And it's really important to have a safety driver monitoring system. We'll discuss some factors. So at first, the decision was made by the software that car was designed to ignore the detection. But the first initial, before decision making, the victim was first classified as an unknown object. Then it misclassifies a vehicle. And then it also misclassifies a vehicle bicycle. So you can see there is an error between perception and attentiveness that should not have led the vehicle to ignore an object like this. So the combination of, you can say, perception failure to correctly identify the pedestrian with the vehicle and the planning to avoid the detective object, even though its class was uncertain, that ultimately led to the failure of it and the also lack of human or emergency braking backup system that led to such fatality. We can see from such incidents that every aspect of autonomous driving, perception, planning, and control, that overall contribute and can lead to the failures and crashes, and that often the interaction of multiple system, or you can say multiple decision-making system, can lead to such unanticipated consequences. So in fact, there are many, many factors and autonomous systems can fail. Let's have a sense for the challenge of safety assessment, and formally we'll define some basic safety. Also, like, I like to question you, like, there can be still so many reasons the such incidents can happen, or like while making the decision approach or decision taking, the system might sometimes go into the dilemma situation. Yeah, you can say, like, for example, I like to give an example, like if an unmarked area is there and there is an uncertainty of a pedestrian crossing a road. So our autonomous car was like designed by the rules. So it was made and designed to run on a road. It goes with the rule system. But as a human, maybe in the case that there is unmarked road, the car doesn't know that it's going against the law or something. So if pedestrian breaks the law or cross and comes into between, the system goes into the dilemma state, and that leads to some consequences, and it's hard for it to make that decision. Ultimately, it results into a crash. Yeah, we'll not go much into deep, but let's discuss some hazard sources. I have like categorized some 6 possible hazard sources. On what basis, or like hazard, you can refer to like physical harm to some living things and the probability of that event that can occur with severity of harm. It's basically a threat to a safety. So hazard sources, it can be a mechanical, that can be because of incorrect assembly of the things, electrical, faulty wiring, hardware like computer chips failure, software, maybe some bugs in the evaluating software, perception, that means the sensors, incorrect planning, also fallback. So fallback, you can say to in terms of human drive, by not providing enough guidance to the operator, and also cyber, maybe some hacking attack or by an outsider. Overall, all sources contribute to the factors that can cause hazard. So here I took one example that, like, to just to show you, this is basically, you can say, designing a scenarios. So let's imagine the scenarios, and two vehicle collisions are characterized by impact configuration. So the factor is applicable to both collisions between motor vehicles and also motor vehicle and a pedal cycle. Yeah, I have defined the 6 cases here. You can see, so for the collision between a motor vehicle and a pedestrian, following impact are possible. First is front to rear. You can see on the top left image. So vehicle driving forward and striking a pedestrian, depending on the position of a pedestrian. It may be front left or front right corner. Also, second thing to take into consideration is this side. Vehicle is turning, or you are, let's assume you are taking a turn or sliding little bit out of control, and you strike a pedestrian with one of its side. Also rear side. So vehicle is backing and striking a pedestrian. So the discussion so far shows that the crash is highly complicated, and we can conclude that it's a multidimensional process with multitude of factors. Can be like million of factors. So this is just an example to have an idea. Now we'll go into the safety concept. I hope you understand, like, what's the real safety necessity or the requirements for overall safety, and what are the factors that contributes to the hazard or an accident. Yeah, ISO 26262 is a safety standards that regulates the functional safety of a road vehicles. It recommends the use of hazard analysis and risk assessment, that is HARA, method to identify various hazardous events in the system and to specify the safety goals that mitigate the hazards. The standards follows the well-known, like the model with the, or the architecture of this protocol is a V-shaped model. I'll show you in the further slide. So ACL, you can see the automotive safety integrity level. That refers to the risk classification scheme that is defined with the ISO 26262 standards for an item description of a subsystem in an automotive system. So ASIL basically represents the degree of rigor. For example, you can say testing techniques, what type of documentations are required for reducing the risk of the item. So there are two or three ASIL levels are defined on which the safety assessment is done. And let's say if ASIL D is there, that represents the highest level. And ASIL A, it represents the lowest risk. Yeah, so we can by using the various analysis techniques, and we can define by the ASIL standards or come to a conclusion and conclude a statement like how safe is this. ASIL assessed is for a given hazard and it's first assigned to the safety goal. We must first define the safety goals to set to address the hazard, and it is inherited by the safety requirements that derive from the goal. So, and if there are different analysis methods, HARA, hazard and risk assessment, FTA, fault tree analysis, FMEA, failure mode and effect analysis. We'll see that into detail. So just to have an idea between first, I told ISO 26262 is a safety standard. Before it was ISO 21448. These are the two safety standards. FUSA means functional safety and safety of the intended function. And in interaction point or in middle, you can see there are safety analysis method. So I define HARA as hazard and risk assessment, fault tree analysis, failure mode and effect analysis, HAZOP, STP, and so on. So let's first go to NHTSS standards. So NHTSS stands for National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. It's an US federal government form, and it recommends a strong and extensive testing program before any service is launched for the public. So this testing really rely on the three pillars. You can say simulation, testing, and public road driving. So here I showed you the 12 principles of automated driving that can or will improve the performance in most of the situation if you compare to that of human drivers. So it will obviously not eliminate the risk of accidents or crashes, but the goal is to present a generic approach for tackling the risk that are you saw by the accident or introduced by the automated vehicles. This general generic approach, and you can even interpret it as this as a baseline for, you can say, baseline for safe automated driving. It does not define a specific product that is complete and safe. So let's go quick short definition of all the 12 principles, you can say. So first is safe operation. So deal with the degradation, if safety related functions or the system components become hazardous, unavailable at the time of driving. So in safe operation, it defines a fail operation, the loss of safety related function of the system components and shall not lead to safety related situation. Second one is operational design domain. This is really an important factor that contributes to the overall safety. So ODD is the abbreviation of that. So it basically manages typical situations like automated driving system. It will take into account the situation that can typically be expected into the design domain and addresses the possible risk. So as soon as the system limits the district, or you can say safe functionality, so it recognizes, detects it, and it reacts to that to compensate, or it will give a notice to a driver for a takeover request, with a sufficient time frame for the takeover. Automatic function is not more possible, so it indicates the driver to take over and go it into manual mode. Also, vehicle operator initiated handover. So engaging and disengaging the automatic driving system shall require explicit interaction from vehicle operator that indicates a highly confidence or an intent. So it basically monitors the driver attentiveness. Obviously, fourth one is security. Fifth is user responsibility. So aspects of the driving task will remain under the user's responsibility, must be clear to the user. The user must be aware of his responsibility. You can say mode awareness. So another is vehicle initiated handover, interdependency between the vehicle operator and the autonomous driving system. Another is safety assessment. We'll already discuss some safety assessment and verification. Validation shall be used to ensure the safety goals are met as to reach our consistent improvement for the overall safety. Also, data recording is important. Passive safety, behavior in traffic, safe level. So all these 12 principles that defines a standard for the fail-safe mechanism, you can say. So the car must also, after that, it is very helpful like to have a crash data to analyze. Like after the accident happened, it's really important to have the crash data to analyze and design the system that can avoid specific kind of crash in the future and to resolve the questions about like what things went wrong and who was at the fault during the event. The final step is to ensure our natural confidence in automation and it does not lead to unnecessary hazards being introduced by early adopters. So yeah, just keep in mind, like these are the suggested area that any company should work on. It's not mandatory or requirement yet. I already mentioned the main objective of NHTSA is to guide the companies to build a safe self-driving cars without any restriction and innovation. So let's summarize this. It's not the end, but I think it's going boring or maybe too much information. So let's summarize up to now and we have discussed few of the first accidents that self-driving industry has seen and reveal also many ways in which the software can fail or various contributing factors. And we formally then define hazard, risk, safety, and our listed major sources of the autonomous vehicle hazard. Then we also review the NHTSA safety framework. And in the next slide, we'll discuss some industry perspective on self-driving cars, as well as some safety recommendation for the self-driving cars. There are a few questions in my mind also and might also wonder like how to ensure vehicle reaches a safe state when the hazard occurs, how to identify the hazards. These are the various industry methods for safety and testing. Like I basically did a case study on the two companies. Formerly, it was a Google self-driving car. Now it's Waymo and also General Motors. So I come to a conclusion like Waymo or Google self-driving cars, it ensures the safety or systems have backup and redundancy. So this is so that even if a failure occurs, the car is able to switch to a secondary component or a backup to minimize the severity of failures. It must return the vehicle to a safe state, continuing the drive if possible. So this is referred as a functional safety. Also, Waymo emphasizes crash safety as recommended. We saw the NHTSA standards. So it designs its system and ensures that minimum damage to people inside the car in the event of a crash. So next is try to ensure the operational safety. The focus here main is to allowing passengers or the operator to have some level of control over the vehicle. And in such a way that can maintain systems safely. Here you can see there is an approach of like safety through a comprehensive risk management deep integration. This is the approach that basically ensures the hazard scenarios and potential mitigations. You can say that component must also pass the evaluation, that is SOTF, safety of the intended function, and we'll discuss that into more detail. But hardware, and you can also see, or it's important to note that like hardware and software failure are addressed by the functional safety standards. As we already defined, that is ISO 26262, and assessment is done by SOTF. So SOTF basically addresses unsafe actions due to unforeseen seeable misuse by the user, such as user confusion or operator confusion. So SOTF can be seen as an extension of the functional safety process, and specifically is designed to address the challenges of the automated driving function. So There are various safety processes. I'll go into deep in the next following slides. So that is deductive analysis. It's like top to bottom process. Inductive analysis, bottom to top. I'll define that in further slides. And there is also a method called, I already told, it follows the V-shape architecture. The model follows that. So we'll first have a look into that. So SOTF, it employs or uses HARA to identify the hazard that arises from a performance limitation and the misuse. And then it performs a similar sequence of design, unit testing, verification, validation, various things to confirm the safety requirements that have been met. I really suggest, like, if you would like to dive deeper into either of the functional safety or SOTF standards, you can ask for me, or like I'll provide at the end of this seminar some supplementary materials, because it's just can say it's a tip of an iceberg that all falls under a big umbrella of the autonomous driving system. We'll discuss some of the generic safety frameworks. So there is fault tree analysis. It's already mentioned in the previous slide. It's a top-down approach to the safety assessment and failure modes, and the effect analysis as a bottom-up approach to the safety. Then we'll discuss the ideas of functional safety, which are commonly used in software and hardware risk assessment. And we'll discuss some SOTF as an extension to functional safety, and that accounts overall performance limitation and misuse. I forgot to discuss about the hazard and operability study. So it applies for miscellaneous or complex processes, basically focus more on the design perspective, and it's not still in the development process. There are, you can say, various challenges to the functional safety. It's really a complicated things to define the safety goals, items, various methods. There are so many different terminologies, but it all falls, as I say, under the bigger umbrella of functional safety process. So there are various analysis methods, different terminologies, but the concept or idea behind this remains the same. So I have mentioned, just to have a look of the HAZOP methodology, it's important to define the safety goal for assessment. Then we use some guide words. The technical term is brainstorming. Suppose the guide words are, you can say, left lane, right lane, left indicator, this. So by using that guide words, now when the hazard or crash happens, by using the guide words, it examines and evaluates the things, and it compares with the original documentation guideline. So this is just a overview, or you can say flow chart, of the HAZOP methodology. HARA process also, like, first it asks the question, like, what are the safety goals? Why this safety or defined goals are required? When it will come into implementation and how? And I told about the ACL standards, A, B, C, D level. So D is considered the most safer one. A is less safer one. Classification of the event, when the situation analysis is done based on the scenarios, and that overall make up the HARA process. So I'll summarize quickly into this fault trees. We'll discuss as simple frameworks as FTA, FMEA, and some functional safety frameworks like functional safety HARA, SOTF, safety of the intended function. I guess you might got motivation, little bit motivated for safety requirements, various safety analysis method. It's not the end, but in the last slide, I just put a image how self-driving car sees the outside environment. So it's really necessary to classify image segmentation. It's necessary. So it must identify this is various traffic signal signs, construction zone is there. Here it's just a methodology, or by some programming you can also do, like green color is for the identification of fencing or yard or some construction zone. Red boxes that defines the cyclist, or maybe purple for the pedestrian, pink boxes for the other car. So it's basically an example of environment perception. And also, so I like to think that's all for the different safety methods, but I like to discuss more that's not in the presentation. And just to wish and have some questions about these various functional aspects and the methods. The idea behind is to categorize the failure modes for priority. In FMEA, you can see failure mode and effect analysis. The basic idea is to categorize the various failure modes by the priority. So there are few priority criteria, like how serious are the effects, how frequently do they really happen, how easily they can be detected. Based on that, risk priority numbers are generated. You can say as a RPN number. So based on the priority list, RPN numbers are created, evaluates various possibilities that assign the consequences to that, and say like fault tree method. Based on the RPN number, it categorizes the failure different modes that can be used in the further or HARA or next analysis process. So it's more quantitative process as compared to, you can say, failure mode and effect analysis. Just the overview of different safety standards, methods, and thing that brings to the end of presentation.